Marley was the third world's first superstar. Through his music, the rhythms of Jamaican reggae resonated in households around the globe. And this son of an English army captain and a Jamaican girl took on the mantle of legend. The wild dreadlocks, the marijuana smoking appealed to the world's press. But Marley was more important than his image. So who was this natural mystic man with a gentle voice and revolution in his songs?
Bob wanted to be successful. Bob wanted to, Bob really looked at himself as more as a missionary than a performing artist. He never referred, he never liked the term superstar, he never liked the word star. He looked at himself as doing a job, as performing, passing out a gospel that the gift was given to him by God to pass out. He never really looked at himself as a recording artist. He looked at himself as somebody selling a lifestyle, a belief, and stuff like that.
Bob Marley lived by the teachings of Rastafarianism. When he died at the height of his powers, his funeral attracted as big a crowd as his concerts. But above all, it celebrated his devotion to the Rastafari Church with its message of individual righteousness and its belief that Haile Selassie of Ethiopia was the reincarnation of the true God. The religion was treated with suspicion and hostility in Jamaica. Marley's success gave it respectability. Endorsed by the presence at the funeral of the leaders of both the main political parties, who were quick to honor a national hero.
Of his many musical creations, it may be said that special places are reserved for four. Trenchtown Rock, the symbol of his life. No Woman, No Cry, his comforting hand of compassion. One Love, his vision of peace and unity, and Rastaman Vibrations, his deep mystical faith.
He's one of those rare figures that come along perhaps once in a generation, who by some chemistry of themselves, their own genius, takes what is up to then just a folk form and makes it a part of the universal art of the world. That Bob was not by temperament or mind the kind of person who would ever become, say, a part of a party. Bob wasn't at that length, at that level, on that wavelength at all. Political, yes, in that he was one of the most articulate troubadours of the ghetto, its suffering, its pressures, that I have ever heard. And the interesting thing about him is that as he grew in stature, as he became a millionaire, for example, one often wondered, will he tend to go soft, to become gimmicky, to try to appeal to a more commercial market by compromising his statement? And instead, he remained absolutely uncompromising. The range of his interests grew, so that he would sing of Zimbabwe as well as Trenchtown in Jamaica. But the concern remained absolutely the same, uncompromisingly the same.
A corrugated mass of shanty homes divided by ghetto politics and scarred by battles, Trenchtown, Kingston, a town within a town that held for Marley the inspiration that fired his music. It was here that he came to live with his mother and formed his first band, the Wailing Wailers.
At that time, Trenchtown was in the beginning and still today is like a jungle. It's a place where you have a group of people that really and truly that their hopes of surviving in life is very slim and none. So it's like a boiling pot. That will today will explode, tomorrow it won't explode. You know, it's that kind of thing.
You mean you wanna tell me that people really don't need people? Come on! You don't tell me that.
Music flourished in the ghetto. It had its dark sides, like the hustlers, the rip-off record deals, and the random violence. Yet it provided a creative outlet, a chance of escape. In this yard, Marley would play alone or with any musician who drifted by. Others would hang around and the songs would be hammered out, as they are still doing here today.
Those who pretend, they're gonna lose their best friend's friend. Those who pretend, they're gonna lose their best friend. Those who pretend, they're gonna lose their best friend. Those who
Bob had a lot of leadership. He had a lot of conviction. He was a very good person, that. When you got to know him, you could learn a lot from him, man. He strive for perfection. That's what I found different about him. When he does things, he tries to evoke the best possible out of him. He never tries to cheat anyone by cheating himself. In other words, why Bob was so creative and wouldn't copy other people's tunes, because he said, like, by the sense doing somebody tunes like you don't believe in yourself. If you believe in yourself, then you must create. So things like this, Bob was very inspiring for me.
In the years that followed, Marley pulled together some of the best musicians in Jamaica. His female backing group, Judy Mowat, Rita Marley, his wife, and Marcia Griffiths were collectively known as the I3s.
His message was mainly for the, you know, it's for the oppressed, political and otherwise. It's a reality, things that people feel and live daily. And this is why I think they respond so much to it, to his message in particular, because it's an everyday thing that people feel, and it's a struggle. And it's not that people like to be reminded of depression, but it gives them more strength and upliftment to know that they are not alone in this, and at least there's someone who is there trying to pull, you know, make a headway, so all this can be remedied soon.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. 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 Sick and tired of your hissing, skissing, trying to go to heaven in a hissing, skissing. We know and we understand, Almighty God is a living man. You can fool some people sometimes, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And now you see the light, you stand up for your right.
The message was simple and effective. Yet both the message and Marley got dangerously entangled in the Jamaican elections of 1976. Michael Manley's left-wing government found itself facing economic collapse. A deep split with America had opened up over Manley's friendship with Cuba and the newly formed revolutionary government of Maurice Bishop of Grenada. Near civil war broke out as gangs from the rival parties clashed in a wave of killings. As a national figure, Marley found himself drawn unwillingly into politics. His sympathy lay with Manley, yet he hoped his music might heal the bitterness. Instead, it nearly got him killed.
It was in December 1976. It had to be around September. I drove to Hope Road, where's Bob's home, 56 Hope Road, where his studio was, to see him. So we're sitting in the yard, and I said to him, you know, why don't we do something this Christmas, since we're not going out of the country, to make some money and need to put on some Christmas morning shows. And Bob's statements to me were, you know, I really don't want to make any more money off the Jamaican people. So let's do something for free so everybody can come. Because at that time, the country was in a turmoil. People were down. So he says, let's do something for free. And so we went to see the prime minister and gave him our idea. The prime minister was then Michael Manley. You know, we asked him not to make it political, and he said he wouldn't. But then it became political. And then we started getting messages like from the opposition. They didn't want it held at Jamaica House, and they didn't want it held here, and they didn't want it. And then finally, on the Friday, December the 3rd, I got a message saying that they didn't want a concert, period. So I told them to tell the opposition party that if they have something to talk to me about, they send for me, they come and talk to me, but I don't take messages from messenger boys. Well, that was it, and that night, that was, you know, we're in the house, and the gunshots started firing. Everybody was caught by surprise. It was strictly off guard. It was a very professional assault. It wasn't an amateur assault. It was a very professional assault. And we've had several explanations. We have been explained to by the Prime Minister of Jamaica that it was a mixture of the CIA and the local opposition party in trying to uproot the Prime Minister. You know, we've gotten explanations of that. The fact that he got out of the incident without being bruised with all the shots fired at him made him really believe that he was a worker of God.
Bob goes to prove that he's a Rastaman and he's ordained by God himself. He wasn't a worldly man. He wasn't a man of this world, really. He wasn't a man of material. He's more like a spiritual man, and he had a work to do, and he has done it very well. Yeah, and set a pace and an example for us, especially the blacks in struggle coming from the ghetto. You know? So, Bob is a master, Rastaman.
The peace concert, when it finally happened 2 years later, was everything Marley had hoped for. The high point of the evening came when Seaga and Manley joined Marley on stage, clasping hands in a symbol of peace. He was undergoing a transformation from cult hero to international superstar. For Marley, it was a turning point in his career.
I think his consciousness on money was beyond where a lot of people would have thought it to be. In this, I remember in the early years when Marley got propositioned to tour. He got a proposition at the same time, I think, Toots should tour with The Who, and Marley was supposed to tour the Rolling Stones. I think Marley turned on the tour and played for like 500 and 600 seaters. And Toots played for the crowds that was like 60,000 and more. But what it did, it allowed Marley to have built his own audience.